Welcome to the session, everyone. Thanks for joining us. My name is Mark Dempsey. I work for Carolina Farm Stewardship Association.
I'm Pat Battle. I'm the director of Living Web Farms.
And we're happy for you to join us today. We're going to be talking about the role of sunshine in improving soil fertility via the soil microbial food web and doing our best to maximize the cover of soil by plants and the important role that we think that plays in soil fertility and crop management. So let's just go ahead and jump right on in. So for a little bit of background, we think that plants are excellent regulators of the environment in which they live, of this soil environment. So they use the resources that they have at hand, which is really only sunshine, water, air, and some nutrients, to form these partnerships with soil microbiology. And in turn, those partnerships can improve nutrient access for plants, among a lot of other things that we'll talk about in just a moment. And so in this sense, solar energy capture by plants is this kind of unique bottleneck to the way plants function in this sort of hot and humid Southeast, where they aren't really limited by the amount of water. We're not trying to grow plants in a desert here in the humid Southeast, and we're not trying to grow in a tundra. And so in a way, this sunshine is the thing that kind of limits the biological activity that plants enable underground through those partnerships, and to a large degree, some of the nutrients that they have access to.
And I think, Mark, you gave me just today, because you researched it for this talk, the easiest way to maybe get people to get the point we're trying to make. You researched the efficiency of the use of sunlight by plants. And it surprised you and surprised me. They're only about 5% efficient, right? So if you only have your crops out there, you're only getting 5% of this incredible wealth called solar energy. If you have other plants around them, they are also each getting 5%. And they're all pumping that energy into the soil. So the fact that they're inefficient unto themselves, so supposedly, that's actually our judgment, but the fact that they only get 5% that we can measure efficiency from that sunlight is greatly remediated by the fact that there can be tons of plants, and that's what you see in nature. You see every bit of solar capture possible in most natural landscapes. And that's the point we're trying to make here.
Yeah. So given that efficiency is quote unquote low, it's on us, the managers of our farms or fields or whatever, to do our best to try to like maximize space because efficiency is a little bit low. So that's a good way to think of it. So to talk a little bit about cooperation between plants and soil microbes, I think it's important to think about this all the way through. So the plants select soil microbes that they partner with basically from the moment that they germinate, which I think is like super fascinating. So as they're germinating, they're selecting the bacteria and the fungi and other critters underground that they're choosing to be their partners. And plants don't just kind of take from their friends in this instance. They actually invest significant resources in these partnerships that are like microbes living in their roots, around their roots, and in the soil just beyond that. And it's noteworthy that the majority of carbon fixed by plants, that's like through the process of photosynthesis, powered by sunshine, about half of that carbon makes its way underground. So plants are kind of like pumping a lot of it, or it's actually more than half, but the majority is going underground. And about half of that is actually released to soil microbes to feed those microbes or to communicate with them. There's definitely like two very distinct channels going on there. But the idea is that they're fostering this environment that is beneficial mutually to the plant and to the microbe, and they talk to each other a lot so that they know what each other wants or needs in that sense. So in return, soil microbe partners help provide water to plants, they help provide nutrients to plants, and also protection from pathogens. It's like a fascinating microscopic world under there if you're not already familiar with it. So just for a very brief rundown of some of the relationships that exist between plants and their microbial partners, at the top of the list that you may or may not have heard of, this is a pretty well-known one, is mycorrhizal fungi. So it's fungi that partner with plants via their roots. And you can see some photos here. The photo on the top right is a pine seedling germinating that's intended to just show the extent of this quote-unquote hyphal network. That's like the
fungus version of a root, essentially, the hyphal network that extends out from beyond the roots. And I can't account for the veracity of this photo. I feel like this photo is everywhere over the web. It could be a Photoshop thing, but it illustrates a point, right? This is like a very extensive hyphal network that's extending from a root system. The photograph on the bottom right shows fungal hyphae reaching from a fine root of a plant, and fine root means like the teeniest, tiniest of roots, which you can see that in the picture, it's a pretty fat root. And the little thread-like structures that are coming off of that are reaching over to a soil particle, and they're teeny tiny. And that's important to note because one of the roles of mycorrhizal fungi is to vastly increase surface area. And so by having these teeny tiny thread-like structures that network throughout the soil, have a much higher surface area than even the finest of fine roots of plants do, they enable plants to access more nutrients and water and so on that they otherwise wouldn't have access to. And so that fungal hyphae that branches between the root and the soil particle is literally fungal hyphae checking out the soil particles, looking for water, looking for nutrients. And fungal hyphae have a unique ability to mine soil minerals that most plants do not have the ability to, or they have just extra abilities to do that. And simply because of the added surface area that they have, they vastly improve access to water and to a large extent to nutrients.
The point about minerals, I think, is one that we all want to really reflect on. It is a major motivation for maximizing your plant populations rather than going for bare spacing of soil, because industrial ag and much of our food system is looking at a phosphorus abyss. We as a world agricultural community based on industrial ag are going to run out of phosphorus, probably before we run out of oil. It's a major issue. It's an issue for geopolitical disturbances, etc. That issue is incredibly less severe if you are harnessing the power of mycorrhizae. Mycorrhizae have the ability, the vascular arbuscular mycorrhizae have the ability to exude acids that make appetite, the raw phosphorus in the soil, which is still a lot of it there, available to plants. It's just that we've become dependent on this, you know, chemical fertilizer, which actually, when you apply it, suppresses the mycorrhizae's motivation for making this available. And yes, most plants that we grow, with the exception of brassicas and chenopodiums, the beet family, you know, have this ability. So if you have more plants growing more mycorrhizae, you are accessing more phosphorus and are less susceptible to that particular aspect of fragility in the current food system.
Agreed. Yeah, that's a great point. And while I know this talk is focused on soil nutrient kind of access or management, it's worth re-emphasizing that mycorrhizal fungi, that partnership, is also important for water. The photo on the bottom right is actually two, I think, cotton plants, one grown with and one grown without mycorrhizal associations under drought conditions. And I think it's pretty clear which one had the mycorrhizal associations, the one that has just overall better growth on the right, enabled only by the fact that it had the association with mycorrhizae and ability to get more water.
So moving on, nitrogen-fixing bacteria is another really important one that you should be thinking about in your crop management and definitely from a nutrient management perspective. And so I'm gonna guess that most people are familiar with this relationship between plants and certain bacteria and soil, and it's most well known through legumes. And so the two pictures on the bottom are nodules of different legumes that contain bacteria that fix nitrogen from the atmosphere as if it were free, although it comes at an energetic cost to the plant provided through sunshine. We know legumes to be the big nitrogen fixers, but it's important to note, or at least consider, that legumes are not the only nitrogen fixing plants in quotes, because it's actually the microbes that are doing the work, but there's a good bit of other nitrogen fixation that can happen across a lot of different kinds of plants that maybe spans somewhere between 5 and 10 types of bacteria, at least that we know of. And so the example on the top right is sugarcane. Sugarcane is probably the best known example of a non-legume nitrogen fixation situation. The name of that bacterium is given just below the sugarcane line there. And it actually hosts that bacteria between its cells within the stem, maybe within the roots, but definitely like within just like the above ground plant itself, which is thought to be why sugarcane stands remain productive over, you know, a few years without adding nitrogen, just because they're actually able to get this stuff from the air without having to pull as much from the soil. And it just so happens that that bacterial species and a handful of other ones have been noted in other crop species that range across a bunch of different kinds of crops. And I think we don't know enough about it to say like you should plant this to get added nitrogen to the situation, but that maybe the take home is that there is a benefit to plant diversity that enables you to take advantage of nitrogen fixation.
And there's some pretty astounding examples of this. One that I love to share, when I learned it, I just like, you know, got to marvel in the wonder of nature yet again. Zev Friedman shared with me that there's a indigenous corn that actually sends out adventitious roots up its stalk, and on those roots there are nitrogen fixing bacteria. So it is accessing nitrogen for the corn from the atmosphere. And that, of course, is what the whole point is. Our atmosphere is largely nitrogen, and plants have to access that, and they count on the life for that. So the more we create the diversity, the more forms of life that are there, the better chance that plants will have their moment to capture nitrogen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's a fun and weird example. Look that one up. The pictures of the goop growing on the adventitious roots is pretty neat. Okay, so moving on, I guess one other kind of broad category of partnership that, between plants and microbes, is just so-called plant growth promotion. And there's like, it's a huge umbrella category, sort of on purpose, that provides a variety of maybe quote-unquote services to plants, including things like pathogen protection. So if you have pathogens that are trying to find their way into plant roots, for example, there's quite a few bacteria species that are able to improve the resistance to that. And the same is true for other things like stress tolerance. There are certain bacteria that can help a plant basically physiologically take on more stress, whether that's like water stress, nutrient stress, et cetera, other abiotic stresses. And then of course, nutrient acquisition through pathways that we haven't actually talked about that are not mycorrhizal or nitrogen fixing. You can pause this and look up any of the references that are shown here. There's some pretty neat research that's been done on this. A lot of cool work and a lot of cool relationships. However, it is my opinion that despite knowing a lot of really cool things about soil microbes, that we probably know far less, or there's probably far more unknown relationships than ones that we actually do know about. That's my gut take on that. Yeah. We can learn about them in time. It's just where we're at. We're sort of at this cutting edge, and this is where we are now.
But a point I love to make, I've made in giving beneficial insect talks, where people want to know every last thing. It's like, you know, I don't know every last thing for sure about either soil biology or beneficial insects. But what's important is I create the conditions for the life, because the life does know it. We don't have to know it, the plants know it. As long as we make sure they're there and they have the opportunity, they're going to be doing it whether we know it or not.
Yep, absolutely.